It's a beautiful Lord's Day today. So good to see everybody. I want to encourage you to have a Bible out and open to Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23 be the first passage that we look at. And we're going to be studying the thief on the cross this morning. And this is the account that we have in the New Testament of this event. We have a good number who are visiting with us today, so very thankful for your presence. This is Mother's Day, according to our calendar, and I know that that is of special interest to many of us here today. We don't always coordinate the sermons that we have according to the world's calendar, and of course, we haven't done so today, but we appreciate your presence, whatever it is that has brought you to be with us today. We're so very glad that you're here. And as always, if you have any questions about anything that you hear or anything that you have observed while you're here with us, would you let us know? We'd be most grateful to have the opportunity to get with you at your convenience and with an open Bible address any spiritual questions that you may have. The sermon that we're looking at today has not come about because of the calendar, but because of a conversation that I had with a member here regarding the opportunities that she has to talk with her religious friends and those that she knows in her everyday life, and the challenge that the argument from the thief on the cross poses to her and to others of us as we are trying to teach our friends and neighbors to have an accurate understanding of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's read the text before us. Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. Jesus has been nailed to the cross, and he is hanging between two thieves. It says, "Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, 'If you are the Christ, save yourself and us.' But the other, answering, rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' Then he said to Jesus, 'Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' And Jesus said to him, 'Assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.'" Before our Lord ascended into heaven, he gave the great commission to his apostles. They were to go into all the world and preach to every creature. And the gospel that they were authorized and commissioned by Christ to preach was, "He who believes and is baptized will be saved." Mark chapter 16 and at verse 16. Many people that we know, many people that we come into contact with, perhaps even people who are close to us, will not accept the gospel the way Jesus commissioned it. They insist that they are saved by faith only, prior to and without water baptism. And those who hold this view, who reject the necessity of water baptism for salvation, will often bring up the thief on the cross. Regardless of anything else the Bible may say on this subject, they believe that since this thief is saved without water baptism, then that means that they can be saved without water baptism. And this is the argument that is used by individuals. I remember when I was in high school, after I had obeyed the gospel, I was talking to a good friend of mine who happened to be the son of the pastor in the church that I was a member of. And he was quite upset with the fact that I had left that church, had obeyed the gospel. And he said, "Are you telling me that when Jesus forgave the thief on the cross, that he came down from the cross and he took the thief down from the cross and he went and he baptized him and then nailed him back up to the cross and then put himself back up on the cross?" Well, of course not. That's absurd, but the absurdity of that was his point. He believed that this was proof that you do not have to be baptized in order to be saved. Now, it sounds like a good argument. It sounds like a good argument, but it's not. It has an answer. And that's what we're going to do this morning. We've looked at this before. We're going to look at it again today. We're going to look at the answer. We're going to look at our Lord's power on earth to forgive sins. We're going to talk about what happened when Jesus died on the cross regarding the old law and regarding the new law. And then we're going to talk about what the Bible says about baptism and whether or not it really is essential for our salvation. What is the purpose of water baptism? So that's what we're going to look at this morning. I hope that we have your attention. If you're here, you're a member of the Church of Christ, and you say, you know what? I've heard that argument from people before. Then let's study together, and let's arm ourselves to be ready to teach the truth on this subject. But maybe you're with us this morning, and you believe that you're saved by faith only. You believe that you're saved prior to and without water baptism. You believe the salvation of the thief on the cross proves that. I hope you'll pay attention. I hope that you will have your Bible out and you'll give careful and honest consideration to the things that we have to say here this morning. Let's start by making the point that Jesus, while He was here on this earth, while He was going through His ministry, Jesus had the power on earth to forgive sins. So we're going to look at some times when Jesus did forgive sins, and we're going to notice what prompted Jesus to forgive these sins. Let's start in Luke chapter 7. Turn back just a few pages in the Gospel of Luke to Luke chapter 7. Jesus is eating at the house of a Pharisee, and a sinful woman comes up behind him and begins to wash his feet, to anoint them with oil, and to wash them with her tears, wipe them with her hair. And the Pharisee is astonished, and he thinks in himself, if Jesus really is who people say He is, then He'll know who this woman is. There's no way He would have her touching Him. And Jesus addresses this. Look here at the end of this exchange, down in verses 48 through 50 is what we want to notice here. Luke chapter 7, verses 48 through 50, then He said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." And those who sat at the table with Him began to say to themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Then He said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." So here's an instance where Jesus on earth forgave sins. He forgave this woman her sins, and He says it was her faith. Your faith has saved you. So here's one case. But let's look at another one. In Matthew chapter 19, this is an instance where Jesus offers forgiveness, offers salvation, and it's not accepted. This is the rich young ruler. Matthew chapter 19, starting at verse 16. "Now behold, one came and said to Him, 'Good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?' So He said to him, 'Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments.'" Notice here, He doesn't say anything about his faith. He tells him to keep the commandments. He said to him, "Which ones?" Jesus said, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said to him, "All these things I have kept from my youth. What do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me." But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Not a word in this passage is said about his belief. Nothing is said about his faith. Jesus mentions the commandments. Keep the commandments. "Well, I've done that, yes, but you lack something." Jesus knows his heart. "Sell everything that you have. Your possessions are keeping you from following the Lord fully. You're going to have to get rid of those. Now, we understand that what Jesus tells the rich young ruler here is not a universal condition for salvation. We understand that. We don't tell each other, you've got to liquidate your assets, get rid of everything in order to go to heaven. No, this is something that this man needed to do. So Jesus offers forgiveness, offers life, not on the terms of faith, but on keeping the commandments, and a challenge this man had to overcome, but it's not accepted. But notice, it was offered in the conditions. Let's look at one more. In Matthew chapter 9, turn back just a few pages in the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapter 9, let's read verses 1 through 8. Matthew chapter 9, verses 1 through 8. So he, that is Jesus, so he got into a boat, crossed over, and came to his own city. Then behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, Son, be of good cheer, your sins are forgiven you. And at once some of the scribes said within themselves, This man blasphemes. But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, Why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven you, or to say arise and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. Then he said to the paralytic, Arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. And he arose and departed to his house. Now when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God, who had given such power to men. Jesus claimed that he had power on earth to forgive sins, and he proved it by healing the paralytic. But I want you to notice in the text, the paralytic is not told to repent. He's not told to be baptized. He isn't even told to believe. Did you notice here that in this instance, it was the faith of his friends that motivated Jesus to forgive the sins? Now, maybe the paralytic is included in that word there. Maybe so. But it wasn't just his faith alone. It was their faith as a whole that resulted in his sins being forgiven. Well, what's the point? What's the point that we're making here? The point is that when Jesus was alive on earth, he had the power to forgive sins, and he did so at his own discretion. He did it whenever he wanted to, with whomever he wanted to, however he wanted to. And that's what we see in the gospel accounts. The thief on the cross is just one of these examples. The thief on the cross is there with the woman who was there at the supper, the rich young ruler who had the opportunity, this paralytic. The thief on the cross is just one of many examples of Jesus forgiving sins and granting eternal life however he wanted to while he was here on earth. But what we have to note, here's the point that has to be made, everything changed when Jesus died on the cross. Everything changed when Jesus died on the cross. And when you're talking with your religious friends and neighbors about what you have to do to be saved, it's very important that you be willing to take the time to make this point and to study this out. When I was in denominationalism, I heard a lot of sermons. I heard a lot of preaching. I sat in a lot of Sunday school classes. I don't recall ever once talking about the difference and the dispensations and the covenants and the importance and significance of what happened when Jesus died on the cross. And that lies at the very heart of being able to understand the thief on the cross and why he was saved without water baptism. But you're saying that we have to be baptized to be saved. So you need to prepare yourself to be able to do some teaching on what exactly happened at the cross and help people to understand the change in the covenants, the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament, the most basic division in the Bible. You need to be able to help people to understand that. What happened when Jesus died on the cross? Well, for one thing, the law of Moses was fulfilled and taken away. Turn to the book of Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. Again, if you talk with your religious friends and neighbors, those that you're trying to teach, ask them a question: are we living under the Ten Commandments today? Do we have to keep the Ten Commandments today? You're probably going to get a yes. Yes, it's in the Bible. It's a part of God's will. And again, there's that failure to understand. Never been taught. Likely they've never been taught about the change in covenant. In Colossians chapter 2 and at verse 14, Paul is writing to a church that's being influenced by false doctrine, and there's a segment of this false doctrine, there's a flavor of this false doctrine that has a Jewish source to it. They're being taught that they're going to have to keep the law of Moses if they're going to serve God acceptably, if they're going to be saved. And Paul says, no, the law of Moses is no longer in effect. And he makes the point in this way, Colossians 2, verse 14, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. What was that handwriting of requirements? Well, you look at the context, it's the law of Moses. What happened to the law of Moses? Jesus took it out of the way. When? That's the point we're making here. When? At the cross. When Jesus was nailed to the cross, that old law was nailed there too. When Jesus died on the cross, that old law was taken away. Why was it taken away? It was taken away because it was fulfilled. It was taken away because it served its purpose. Look at Romans chapter 10 and verse 4. Romans chapter 10 and verse 4. Romans 10 verse 4 says, "For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes." What does that statement mean, that Christ is the end of the law? Does that mean when Jesus showed up, there went law? That Jesus took all law out of the way. There is no law. Well, that wouldn't be true because Galatians speaks of the law of Christ. Jesus didn't take away all law. It's talking about the law of Moses. Here's the point that Paul is making. When you take a look at the law of Moses, as it's instituted there at Mount Sinai, if you look down the path of time, it points to the cross. That's the purpose that the law was given. It wasn't meant to last forever. It served a purpose to take the Jew to the cross. So as you take a look at the law and you look all the way down at the end of it, there's the cross. And there's Jesus on the cross. He's the end of the law for righteousness. Now you take Romans 10 verse 4 and you couple that with Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17. This is Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. He says, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill." The law of Moses served a purpose. It was that schoolmaster, it was that tutor, Galatians chapter 3, to bring the Jew to Christ. But when Christ came, and specifically when Jesus died on the cross, the law served its purpose, it was fulfilled. It was fulfilled, and it was taken out of the way. It wasn't ripped up and thrown in the trash. It was fulfilled. It served its purpose. We're no longer under that law. But that law wasn't just taken away, and then we're left in a vacuum with nothing else. No. When Jesus died on the cross, the law of Moses was fulfilled and taken away, and our Lord's law went into effect. In particular, His last will and testament. It's important. When you're talking with your friends about the thief on the cross, you need to remember Hebrews chapter 9. You need to take them to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, verses 15 through 17. The Hebrew writer here makes a point that we're still able to understand today. Because back then they had people who would make testaments or make wills that would stipulate what was to happen to their property after they died, and we do the same thing today. So we should all be able to understand the point the Hebrew writer is making here. Hebrews chapter 9, verses 15 through 17. And for this reason, he, that is Christ, for this reason, he is the mediator of the new covenant. What happened to the old covenant? The old covenant's gone. It was fulfilled. It was nailed to the cross. It's gone. Now we have a new covenant. For he is the mediator of the new covenant by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where there is a testament, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is in force after men are dead, since it has no power at all while the testator lives. And that's true today as well. When someone makes a will, that will does not go into effect until they die. Now, after they die, the will goes into effect, and whatever property they have is going to be dispensed the way that will stipulates. But prior to their death, they can do with their property whatever they want. This is easy to illustrate. My mother is still alive. There's part of me that wishes I was in Oklahoma today. My mother is still alive. I have one sibling. It's just me and my younger sister. My mother, if she wants to, she can give any of her furniture, any of her property, any of her money in her bank accounts, her car, she can give any of that to either one of us or to anyone for whatever reason she wants to, right? But when my mother dies, then her will is going to go into effect. And the only thing that's going to happen with that property is what the will says is going to happen to it. And if there are any stipulations in that will, my sister and I will have to meet those stipulations in order to get what my mother has given to us. While she's alive, she can do with it what she wants. But after she dies, her will goes into effect. Jesus, while he was alive on earth, he had the power to forgive people of their sins. That's what he had. And he did so whenever he wanted, to whoever he wanted, for whatever reason he wanted. But when Jesus died, his will went into effect. Now, the only way that we can receive what he has to give, the forgiveness of sins, is if we meet the conditions that are set forth in his will. Which law was in effect when the thief on the cross was saved? Jesus lived and died under the law of Moses. The law of Moses was in effect, and it was enforced until Jesus took it away at his death. The promise of paradise was made to the thief before Jesus died. We are living after Jesus died. And that makes all the difference in the world. While the account of the saving of the thief on the cross is a great example of the love and the mercy and the forgiveness of Jesus, I want you to think about that. We've talked about crucifixion. We've talked about the pain that our Lord would have been going through at that time. And for him to have the presence of mind to forgive someone of their sins while he was going through the act of dying for our sins is amazing. That is something to take from the account of the thief on the cross. That our love, our Lord's love and mercy and forgiveness is without measure. And the account of the thief on the cross is a great example of the power of the cross to bring sinners to repentance. Because the Gospels teach that early on in the crucifixion, both of those thieves were railing against Christ. Both of them were shouting out against Him. Something happened somewhere in that 6 hours. Something happened somewhere to cause one of those thieves to come to his senses and to realize he needed to repent, and he did. Those are the truths that are to be taken from the account of the thief on the cross. The thief on the cross is not an example of how you and I are saved today. That's not what that passage teaches. That's not its purpose. When Jesus rose from the dead, He sent His apostles into all the world to preach the gospel. But in fact, what they were doing in preaching the gospel, the apostles were made testators of our Lord's last will and testament. And what they were doing in preaching the gospel, they were going forth and they were setting forth the conditions that have to be met in order for us to receive the forgiveness of sins. Let's go through and let's read the accounts of the Great Commission. It's found in 3 places in the Gospels. And let's start in Matthew chapter 28. This is the one that perhaps is the most familiar to people. In Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." Now let's look at Mark's account of the Great Commission. Mark chapter 16, verses 15 and 16. "And He said to them, 'Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned.'" Matthew mentions baptism. Mark mentions belief and baptism. Look in Luke. In Luke chapter 24, Luke's gospel contains the Great Commission. Luke chapter 24, verses 46 and 47, "Then He said to them, 'Thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in His name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem.'" What do we have when we take all of these accounts, lay them out side by side? What do we learn? The conditions, the stipulations that have to be met, we have to believe. We have to repent. Now, it's not stated in Matthew, Mark, or Luke's account, but we know from Acts 8, and we know from Romans chapter 10 that we must make a verbal confession of our faith, and we must be baptized in order to be saved. These are the stipulations of His will that we must meet today. This is what Jesus said after His death. Remember, His death, His will went into effect. And what was that will? We must believe. We must repent. We must confess our faith. And yes, we must be baptized in order to be saved. That's what the Scriptures teach on this subject. Now, since the thief on the cross is used by many to do away with the necessity of water baptism. No, you don't have to be baptized to be saved. Let's spend just a few moments looking at the purpose of water baptism. What does the Bible say? If you ask people, what is baptism for? Why are you baptized? Well, what's the purpose? You're likely to get any kind of response. A very common response I remember from when I was in denominationalism is that baptism is an outward sign of an inward grace. It's something that you do outwardly to profess to the world what God has already done inwardly. Sounds really good. I haven't found that taught in Scripture anywhere. But that's what was taught. That's what we were taught to say. Or you need to be baptized because Jesus was baptized. You don't have to be baptized, but you need to be baptized because Jesus was baptized. Or, I never did really understand this one, you need to be baptized because Jesus tells you to. You don't have to be, but you need to be. Okay, Jesus tells me to do it, but you're saying I don't have to do it, but I should do it. When you're holding on to a false doctrine, that's the kind of logic you'll come to if you will hold to a doctrine that is proven to be false. You'll find yourself saying things like that. How about if we open the Bible and we let the Bible answer this question? Because the Bible does. What is the purpose of water baptism? Well, baptism saves us. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21, the Old King James Version, baptism doth also now save us. Baptism saves us. We read Mark 16 and verse 16, where Jesus said, "He who believes and is baptized shall be saved." If you have a small grasp on grammar and arithmetic, you can understand Mark 16, 16. If you can work an addition problem, you can understand Mark 16, 16. He who believes and is baptized, and is a conjunction. It joins things together. There's your plus sign. Belief and baptism will be equals salvation. Jesus makes it very easy. Very easy to understand. Baptism saves us. Baptism is for the remission of our sins. In Acts chapter 2, when Peter is preaching the gospel for the first time, here's the first time the conditions of salvation are set forth, the stipulation of our Lord's will is set forth. Acts chapter 2, verses 36 through 38. "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, 'Men and brethren, what shall we do?'" Notice he says, this Jesus is Lord and Christ, and they're cut to the heart. Friends, they believe. They believe that Jesus is the Christ, that He is Lord, and they believe that they're guilty of crucifying Him. Otherwise, they wouldn't be cut to the heart. So here are people who believe, and they ask, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Peter doesn't say, "Well, there's nothing to do. It's obvious you believe, and that's all." No. Jesus says, or Peter rather, "Then Peter said to them, 'Repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins.'" Aren't those the conditions that Jesus gave in the Great Commission? Yes. Repent and be baptized. Why? For the remission of sins. That word F-O-R doesn't mean because of. We never use it that way. He's not saying you need to repent and be baptized because you've received the remission of your sins. In this passage, it means in order to. Repent and be baptized for, in order to have the remission of your sins. No baptism, no remission of sins. No remission of sins, you still have those sins. They're not forgiven. Acts 22 and at verse 16. Here, Saul of Tarsus, who becomes the Apostle Paul, he has seen the Lord on the road to Damascus. So he believes. And he was led by hand into Damascus because he's blinded by the vision. And he's been 3 days without eating or drinking. So he has repented. He believes. He is as penitent of a man as there ever will be. Ananias comes to him, Acts 22 and at verse 16, and now why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. What's the purpose of baptism? I believe Acts 22, 16 sets it forth as plainly as any other passage. I believe you can give Acts 22, 16 to a fourth grader, and they can tell you the purpose of baptism: to wash away sins. Baptism is that act of obedience. It's complying with the stipulation set forth in the gospel in our Lord's last will and testament. And it's there at the act of baptism that our sins are washed away. And that's what it means to call on the name of the Lord from our text. It doesn't mean to give a verbal, audible cry to the Lord. It doesn't mean to say the sinner's prayer. It means to trust that the Lord will do what He says He's going to do if you meet the conditions. You're calling on the Lord for your salvation, not yourself. You're doing it the Lord's way, not your own way. What's baptism for? Washes away those sins. It is at baptism that we contact Jesus' death. While we're turning to Romans chapter 6, you might be saying, now wait a minute, it's the blood of Jesus that washes away our sins. You all in the Church of Christ, you are a bunch of, and I've been called this not very often, you're a bunch of water regenerates. You believe that it's the water that has the power to save you. That the power is in the water. That's what you're preaching. No. It's the blood of Jesus Christ alone that has the power to wash away our sins. The question is, when do we come into contact with that blood? How do we access that cleansing blood of Jesus? When did Jesus shed His blood? At His death. Well, look in Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. And as you're studying with your friends and you're talking with them about the necessity of baptism, include Romans 6. Include Romans 6. Look at verses 3 and 4. Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? Where is it that we contact the death of Jesus at our baptism? And it's at His death where His blood was shed. That's where we contact that. Do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? Therefore, we were buried with Him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. You need to go to this passage because it addresses a number of questions about baptism. For one, it addresses the mode of baptism. It's a burial. You go down and you come back up. It's not a sprinkling. It's a burial. Now, that's clear from this passage. But also, where do we contact the Lord's death and thus His blood? It's in baptism. And look at the last phrase in verse 4. The last phrase in verse 4 says, even so, we also should walk in newness of life. That phrase is important. What is newness of life? It's when life is renewed. It is a statement that is parallel with another statement in Scripture that is a favorite of those who believe in faith-only salvation. John chapter 3, verse 7, you must be born again. You must be born again. Born, there's that life. Again, it's a new. Newness of life, being born again. When does that happen? Before or after baptism? Well, we'll be told by our friends it happens before baptism, but where does the Bible put it? Newness of life comes after baptism, not before. You don't enjoy that newness of life. You're not born again, and then you take that live person and you go and you bury them. You don't bury a live person. You bury the one who is dead in their sins. You bury the one that's dead in their sins, and they come forth to newness of life. Romans 6, 3 and 4 is a great passage. Keep that passage. Keep that passage and use it when studying with people. It's in baptism that we contact Jesus' death. It's after baptism that we enjoy the newness of life, not before. Baptism places us in Christ. Galatians chapter 3. We got this and just one more point to look at. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 27. I want to look at verse 26 with this as well. Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 and 27. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. We're not denying that faith has a role. Yes, it's through faith that we are sons of God in Christ Jesus. But how do we get into Christ? For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. How do we get into Christ? Well, before we address that, what's the significance of being in Christ? We won't take the time to look at it. It's another sermon entirely. But Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14 tells us that every spiritual blessing is found in Christ, including, verse 7, the forgiveness of our sins. We have to be in Christ to enjoy the forgiveness of our sins. How do we get into Christ? The Bible never says that we believe our way into Christ, never says that we repent our way into Christ, confess our way into Christ, pray our way into Christ, or even pay our way into Christ. But it says very plainly, we're baptized into Christ. We're baptized into Christ, and that same act also puts us into the church, the body of saved people. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and at verse 13, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. What is the body? The body is the church. And again, you can take them to Ephesians chapter 1, 22 and 23 to show that the body is the church. The church is the body. It's the body of saved people. The very act that saves us automatically makes us a part of the body of saved people. The Lord added to the church daily those who were saved, Acts chapter 2 and at verse 47. Here's what the Bible says baptism does. Men might say one thing. They may be very sincere in what they say because that's what they've been taught by people that they trust. But what does the Bible say? What saith the Scriptures? We need to be ready to take people to the Scriptures. I want to close with the Scripture that was read for us by Brother Gavin before the sermon began. In Hebrews chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. Hebrews chapter 5, verses 8 and 9 says, though he, that is Jesus, though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Jesus is the architect of his last will and testament. He is the author of eternal salvation. You and I cannot be saved the same way the thief on the cross was saved. We're 2,000 years too late for that. He was saved before Jesus died. We're living long after Jesus died. The last thing Jesus said on the subject is that we must believe, repent, confess our faith, and be baptized in order to be saved. I wonder, have you done what the Bible says you must do in order to be saved? Don't let the thief on the cross rob you of your soul's salvation. Listen to what Jesus tells you that you have to do in order to be saved. Maybe you're with us this morning and you're hearing this for the first time. Maybe this is new to you. I'm asking you to take these things that we've studied and to think about them, to study them out. And if you'd like to talk to me about these things more or anybody else here, we'd be glad to talk with you about this and help you to understand it better. Maybe you do understand it and you realize that you need to be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. We're about to sing an invitation song. And with that song, what we're doing is we're encouraging you or anyone like you that needs to make their life right with God to do it and to do it right now. Just a few weeks ago, we had someone step forward and respond, and we waited patiently while they were baptized, and we'd be glad to do so again. If you understand what you need to do to be saved, you can do that right now. Or maybe you have another spiritual need. Maybe you need to make things right in a public way. Maybe you need our prayers. Whatever your spiritual need is, the invitation is for you. If you need to, would you please come as together we stand and sing this song.